Okay.
Yes, good morrow, indeed. We have, we're actually going to be starting chapter 10, an amazing feat for this class to get through a chapter so quickly. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Good morning, Father. And thank you for your word. Right.
Proper.
A little. think we just simply need to share the gospel with people. You don't have to be like or that sort of theological treatise for your PhD. You have to understand that people respond to love. If they absolutely hate your guts, they will respond to love. They cannot deny your story of what brought you to Christ. They can't say, well, like, wait a minute, I think you got that wrong. No, they can't. And Christians tend to fall into, in my opinion, into two groups, what I call the Martha group and the Mary group. Remember Mary and Martha? Martha said, Lord, would you tell her to quit sitting there, just come over here and help me in the kitchen? And Jesus didn't say, you're absolutely right. We need to be doing more for the poor, the homeless, the drunk, and that's all he said. He says, Martha, you worry about everything. He said, Mary has chosen the better part. He didn't say, Mary has chosen the good part, or Mary, or your part is bad. No, he says, she has chosen the better part. So some of us, and I know very many Christians are good, they're Martha Christians. They work in soup kitchens, they help the homeless, they're always out there doing things to show the love of Christ. They're very physical. Some of us, like Mary, sit at the feet of Jesus. Bottom line is, as we'll see today in this class, that we get that far.
Do you cover a lot of that in chapter 12?
We are covering that. We'll come in chapter 12. We are opening up chapter 10. And chapter 9, as I pointed out, if you dealt with God's past dealings with Israel. In other words, Paul is saying, look, God chose, past tense, Israel, not because they were the nicest, most likely to obey, least likely to fail. Yeah. No. He chose them for his own reasons, and his choice is sovereign. You don't get to question it. Past dealings with Israel. Now, in this chapter, Paul is going to deal with God's present dealings with Israel. What is God doing now? And it does tie into this issue of the Mary and the Martha. And by the way, we need both groups of Christians. I know you'd like to get rid of me, but yeah, Mary time, but yes.
book and chapter.
Romans chapter 10, verse 1. Brethren, my heart's desire and my prayer to God, this is Paul speaking, for Israel is that they might be saved. In other words, he's saying, okay, I know what God did in the past about Israel, but right now they failed to recognize the Messiah. And my greatest hope is that they would come to a realization that the Messiah did come, and he came with salvation, not dominion yet. He came with salvation first. And basically saying, I really hope I can find a way to show the Jews that this is what has happened. Understand something. And what he's saying here is that really God might be working on the Gentiles, but he hasn't stopped working.
they had rules, regulations, sub-rules, they broke everything down to such minuscule level that they said, if you follow all these rules, you'll become righteous. That's what Muhammad would later say. That's what Joseph Smith would later say. That's what Charles Taze Russell would later say. If you knock on these many doors, you ride your bicycle or something. You are trying to establish righteousness according to rules that man invented. And God is saying, you will never be righteous enough for me if you make up your own rules and then you follow those rules. You haven't proven a thing to me. That's what God is saying. You need to understand you will never make it on your own accord. You will never be righteous in my book if you follow your rules. You have to follow my rule. And God's rule is very simple. Surrender your will and your life to Jesus Christ. And so this is what Paul is saying here. The Jews had a zeal for God, and he would know. He persecuted Christians. Before he surrendered his life to Christ, he persecuted Christians with a zeal that was unparalleled. So he's just saying, be careful. But they have not submitted themselves to the righteousness of God. And the righteousness of God is to submit your life to his one and only true self. A lot of people are very sincere. I believe Oprah Winfrey is a very sincere person. She's just sincerely wrong. She's a very, I believe she really believes that, Hindus are good people. No Hindus who are. Indian in-laws through my second brother. She believes that the Muslims are good people. I know a lot of good Muslims. This class prayed for a Muslim surgeon who I knew and befriended, and I helped him with his practice. And he got through his surgery, you remember, so well. He actually was amazed. He said he didn't know that Allah answers prayers. Allah does not answer prayers. This is Yahweh, the God of Israel. And he recovered so quickly from his surgery, he couldn't believe it. He came and he actually brought across some confectionery treats and things like that to thank him. Once he was allowed to the drive, he did that. There are good people in every religion, good by human standards, and there are good people in every nation, tribe, tongue, language, you name it. But by God's standards, they're not.
There's none good, not one.
Not one. Verse 4, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness unto everyone that believe. What he's saying is this. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 18, not one jot or tittle, in other words, not one comma, apostrophe, or full stop, or period, will pass away until all of the law is fulfilled. In other words, when was the law fulfilled? It was fulfilled in Jesus Christ, when he walked the earth. He did not sin, because he's not. He doesn't need to be. Satan said they turned these rocks into stone. Didn't have to. He is. And so, when Christ came to earth, fulfilled the law, was assassinated, crucified, and then resurrected, that was the end of the law if you submitted your life to Jesus Christ. If you decide you are going to reject Christ's offer, then you are still under the law. If you submit your life to Jesus Christ, you're saying, I cannot fulfill the law, but I can submit my life to Jesus Christ. That is what God is offering us. That's the choice. So that's what he meant. He reads in verse 4. He says, for Christ is the end of the law. If you submit your life to Christ, the law has no hold on you. It has no meaning. It is terminated. Jesus Christ is who he said he is, the Son of the living God of Israel. Verse 5, for Moses described the righteousness which is of the law. That is true. Moses came down with the law on two stone tablets. And the man that follows all of those laws shall live by them. In other words, you have to keep all of the law. Now I want you to notice that, of course, you and I know that the Jews and neither could the Gentiles have ever kept the law. We know that. I want you to compare something. You get a chance, look in your Bible. Those of you that have an electronic Bible can do it a lot faster. Exodus 32, chapter 32, verse 28. On the day Moses came down from Mount Sinai, he found them dancing naked around a golden calf. 3,000. Less than 100 years, and probably about 60 years, two generations. Facebook, Twitter, without video, without computers, without jet airplanes, without trains, because it depended 100% on the Holy Spirit. Today, we have many churches in which the Holy Spirit is totally absent. And we have at our disposal some of the most incredible communication tools. We have not done what the early church did. In other words, what I'm saying to you is that without the Holy Spirit, the early church would have died. Without computers, our modern church would die. You get the difference? Correct.
Our modern church.
It will die. Now, to be fair, there are churches in which
without the Holy Spirit, it is dead.
It is dead. It is dead. Yeah. He's using present tense, right?
Yes,
yeah.
I get it.
But this is my point. With the Spirit, people live. With the law, and that is why we have to surrender our will, our lives. Let the Holy Spirit guide our lives. We're surrendering. And in so doing, we're surrendering our lives to Christ. By allowing the Holy Spirit to guide us, to take over our lives, we are submitting our lives to Christ. Because Christ said, when he comes, he will teach you of the things that bring it to your remembrance. Verse 6 and 7. But the righteousness which is of faith speaks on this wise. Say not in your heart, who shall ascend into heaven? That is to say, bring Christ down from above. And who shall ascend into the deep? That is to say, bring Christ up from the dead. This is very, very important. There are those that say, I shall ascend to Mount Everest, I shall sit in the lotus position on top of a hill, and I shall meditate, and I will achieve God consciousness. In other words, I'll bring God down to the top of Mount Everest. Not happening. You do not have the power to bring Christ down to your level. You don't have that power. Okay? And then there are those, call them the Mary or the Gordon Christians, you know, who's diving into the depths of theology, looking for more and more things. And there's nothing per se bad about that. But you don't have to dive. Understand something about Christianity. Have you ever noticed a child could understand Christianity? You don't need to be a doctoral student. There are lots of people, in fact, the majority of Christians came to Christ before they reached the age of conception. Conceptual thinking, not conception. Understand that, and there's a reason why the majority of people become Christians before they reach a ripe old age. Because by that time, you get to my age, Now, what Paul is saying here, he says, you can float on clouds like Shirley MacLaine and Oprah Winfrey. Yeah, I know. I wish I were picking on her and Oprah Winfrey, right? or you can go to one of our modern theological seminaries that are quite liberal and come up with all kinds of new interpretations of who God is. But you're missing the point. You're totally missing the point. Christianity is very simple. It is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, the Messiah. Nothing more. Nothing less, nothing else. That's it. It's really that simple. Verse 8. But what says it? The word is near thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if you shall confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, that's it. You shall be saved. Christ is not known through deep theology. He's not known through being a Gordon. He's not known through philosophy, but through childlike simplicity. That's why the majority of people who come to Christ do so when they're very young. And the older you get, the harder it becomes to surrender your life to Christ. You simply have to believe. You are a sinner. He died for your sins. He is your Lord and Master. It took, for me, a realization that Christ is alive right now. That was one of the first steps I had to make in coming to surrender my life. You see, I guess as a kid looked at it as, you know, this is a really nice story. It's too bad he didn't live. He could have done a world of good if he had only lived. No, he had to die first to pay the sins, for your sins, my sins, everyone else's sins.
He lives through us.
And so therefore, contrary to what I thought as a child, like, oh man, you know, if only he had lived, we would have had a much better world. No, he had to die in order for us to have a much better world. And that I stopped thinking of Christ in the past. That was one of the changes I had to make. And you notice when I talk about Christ now, the verb is always in the present tense, right?